Parables of the Cross by I. Lilius Trotter. And so the springtime expands, till it passes once more into the shadow of Calvary, for the blessedness of receiving is not all that God has for us. A new world lies beyond, a world of giving, a giving first to God in surrender, then to man in sacrifice. A flower that stops short at its flowering misses its purpose. We were created for more than our own spiritual development. Reproduction, not mere development, is the goal of matured being, reproduction, and other lives. There is a tendency in some characters, running parallel to the high cultivation that spends its whole energy on the production of bloom, at the expense of seed. The flowers that are bent on perfecting themselves, by becoming double, end in barrenness, and a like barrenness comes to the soul whose interests are all concentrated upon its own spiritual well-being, heedless of the needs around. The true, ideal flower is the one that uses its gifts as a means to an end. The brightness and sweetness are not for its own glory. They are but to attract the bees and butterflies that will fertilize and make it fruitful. All may go when the work is done. It is more blessed to give than to receive. And we ourselves are saved to save. We are made to give, to let everything go if only we may have more to give. The pebble takes in all the rays of light that fall on it, but the diamond flashes them out again. Every little facet is a means not simply of drinking more in, but of giving more out. The unearthly loveliness of the opal arises from the same process, carried on within the stone. The microscope shows it to be shattered through and through with numberless fissures that catch and refract and radiate every ray that they can seize. Yes, there lies before us a beautiful possible life, one that shall have a passion for giving, that shall be poured forth to God, spent out for man, that shall be consecrated for the hardest work and the darkest sinners. But how are we to enter in? How are we to escape from the self-life that holds us, even after the sin-life has loosed its grasp? Back to the cross. Not only from the world of condemnation, and from the world of sinning, does it free us as we accept it, but from the power of outward things and from the thraldom of self. Not only does it open the door into the world of acquittal, and again into that of holiness, but yet again into the new realm of surrender, and thence into that of sacrifice. For the essential idea of the cross is a life lost to be found again in those around. Let us look at God's picturing. As the plant develops, there comes a fresh stage of yielding. At first, it was only the dead, disfiguring leaves that had to go. Now it is the fair, new petals. They must fall, and for no visible reason. No one seems enriched by the stripping. And the first step into the realm of giving is a like surrender, not manward, but Godward, an utter yielding of our best. So long as our idea of surrender is limited to the renouncing of unlawful things, we have never grasped its true meaning. That is not worthy of the name, for no polluted thing can be offered. The life lost on the cross was not a sinful one. The treasure poured forth there was God-given, God-blessed treasure, lawful and right to be kept, only that there was the life of the world at stake. Death to lawful things is the way out into a life of surrender. Look at this buttercup as it begins to learn its new lesson. The little hands of the calyx clasp tightly in the bud, round the beautiful petals. In the young flower, their grasp grows more elastic, loosening somewhat in the daytime, but keeping the power of contracting, able to close in again during a rainstorm or when night comes on. But see the central flower, which has reached its maturity. The calyx hands have unclasped utterly now. They have folded themselves back, past all power of closing again upon the petals, leaving the golden crown free to float away when God's time comes. Have we learned the buttercup's lesson yet? Are our hands off the very blossom of our life? Are all things, even the treasures that he has sanctified, held loosely, ready to be parted with, without a struggle, when he asks for them? Is it not in the partial relaxing of grasp, with power to take back again, that this fresh victory of death is won? It is won when that very power of taking back is yielded. When our hands, like the little calyx hands of God's buttercups, are not only taken off, but folded behind our back in utter abandonment. Death means a loosened grasp, loosened beyond all power of grasping again. And it is no strange thing that happens to us if God takes us at our word and strips us for a while of all that made life beautiful. It may be outward things, bodily comfort, leisure, culture, reputation, friendships, that have to drift away as our hands refuse to clasp on anything but God's will for us. Or it may be on our inner life that the stripping falls, and we have to leave the sunny lands of spiritual enjoyment for one after another of temptation's battlefields, where every inch of our foothold has to be tested, where even it may seem to give way, till no experience, no resting place remains to us in heaven or earth but God himself, till we are wrecked upon God. Have faith, like the flowers, to let the old things go. Earn his beatitude, his blessed is he, whosoever shall not be offended in me, the beatitude of the trusting, as it has well been called, even if you have to earn it, like John the Baptist, in an hour of desolation. You have told him that you want him only. Are you ready to ratify the words when his emptying begins to come? Is God enough? Is it still, my God, that you cry, even as Jesus cried, when nothing else was left him? Yes, practical death with him to lawful things is just letting go, even as he on the cross let go all but God. It is not to be reached by struggling for it, but simply by yielding, as the body yields at last to the physical death that lays hold on it, as the dying calyx yields its flower. Only to no iron law with its merciless grasp do we let ourselves go, but into the hands of the Father. It is there that our spirit falls, as we are made conformable unto the death of Jesus. Does all this seem hard? Does any soul, young in this life and in that to come, shrink back and say, I would rather keep in this springtime. I do not want to reach unto the things that are before, if it must mean all this of pain. To such comes the Master's voice. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. You are right to be glad in his April days while he gives them. Every stage of the heavenly growth in us is lovely to him. He is the God of the daisies and the lambs and the merry child hearts. It may be that no such path of loss lies before you. There are people like the lands where spring and summer weave the year between them, and the autumn processes are hardly noticed as they come and go. The one thing is to keep obedient in spirit. Then you will be ready to let the flower time pass if he bids you, when the sun of his love has worked some more ripening. You will feel by then that to try to keep the withering blossoms would be to cramp and ruin your soul. It is loss to keep when God says, give. For here again, death is the gate of life. It is an entering in, not a going forth only. It means a liberating of new powers as the former treasures float away like the dying petals. We cannot feel a consciousness of death. The words are a contradiction in terms. If we had literally passed out of this world into the next, we should not feel dead. We should only be conscious of a new, wonderful life beating within us. Our consciousness of death would be an entirely negative matter. The old pains would be unable to touch us. The old bonds would be unable to fetter us. Our actual consciousness would have passed into the new existence. We should be independent of the old. And a like independence is the characteristic of the new flood of resurrection life that comes to our souls as we learn this fresh lesson of dying, A grand independence of any earthly thing to satisfy our soul. The liberty of those who have nothing to lose, because they have nothing to keep. We can do without anything while we have God. Hallelujah! Nor is this all. Look at the expression of abandonment about this wild rose calyx as time goes on, and it begins to grow towards the end for which it had to count all things but loss. The look of dumb emptiness is gone. It is flung back joyously now, for simultaneously with a new dying, a richer life has begun to work at its heart. So much death, so much life, for ever with death it weaveth the warp and woof of the world. The lovely wild rose petals that have drifted away are almost forgotten in the reaching forth unto the things that are before. The seed vessel has begun to form. It is yielded to bring forth fruit. Yes, there is another stage to be developed in us after the lesson of absolute, unquestioning surrender to God has been learnt. A life that has been poured forth to Him must find its crown, its completion, in being poured forth for man. It must grow out of surrender into sacrifice. They first gave their own selves to the Lord and unto us by the will of God. Back to the cross once more. If there is any place where this fresh lesson can be learnt, it is there. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because He laid down His life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. It is the very love of Calvary that must come down into our souls. Yea, if I be poured forth upon the service of your faith, I joy and rejoice with you all. So spoke the apostle who drank most deeply into the Master's Spirit. And again, death worketh in us, but life in you. Neither count I my life dear unto myself, that I may finish the ministry. Deeper and deeper must be the dying, for wider and fuller is the life-tide that it is to liberate. No longer limited by the narrow range of our own being, but with endless powers of multiplying in other souls. Death must reach the very springs of our nature to set it free. It is not this thing or that thing that must go now. It is blindly, helplessly, recklessly our very selves. A dying must come upon all that would hinder God's working through us, all interests, all impulses, all energies that are born of the flesh, all that is merely human and apart from His Spirit. Only thus can the life of Jesus, in its intensity of love for sinners, have its way in our souls.